Okay, so my task is to keep us on time. That means that we have like about 10 minutes for a discussion or so. So we're gonna have to do like a little bit quick set of answers. I'll pose a few questions. We'll see what the panel will think, and if we have some time, I'll try to collect, you know, some data from the panel as well. So my first question would be, when you look back at the domains that you look at, do you see any technology that is, say, as transformative, or do you even think that this is so transformative in your domains? And can you relate it to something? Like, for example, we read in the news, people relate generative AI to, I don't know, like electricity, fire. We hear these kinds of things. And when you think about your own domains, just kind of sincerely speaking, what do you think the impact of generative AI is like? And maybe to pick at, I'll start with you, John. I feel like robotics and AI impacts manufacturing once every decade.
I think it's hard to say. I think it's also increasingly hard to pick out singular contributions, right? Yeah. In my very naive understanding of generative AI, I think for design and manufacturing, we need to build the sort of application-specific tools upon the general capabilities, upon the general models. But we can look back to things like CNC machining, and if you look at the first paper from MIT describing CNC machining in the 1950s, right, the machine is small and then all the vacuum tubes and controls are big, and it's another twist on digital transformation. So, you know, we will see, and it's certainly the combination of the computing and the AI with the hardware, the automation, I think is really important and still really an unsolved, a very hard unsolved problem.
Yeah, that's exciting. Any interesting analogies or thoughts?
I think we saw a huge innovation in healthcare with the advent of neural networks that had the appropriate processing capacity and data to do efficient prediction, right? And so this was pre-generative AI, but it was the advent of neural networks that worked well in specific application settings. I would say that was similarly transformative in the way that certainly technologists were thinking about how you can use AI in applied settings.
That's very exciting.
Yeah. Just quickly, I would say that music's a funny domain because on the one hand, it's common to everybody. Most people listen to music and have some relationship to it. On the other hand, there's an incredible kind of hierarchy and snobism in music. So a lot, we sort of generally assume that only certain people are geniuses and can make music and everybody else consumes music. And so I actually think that the PC and the early 80s when the PC and the Mac came out and MIDI, which allowed all these computers to connect to digital instruments, was a huge change, really big change that meant that most people could get their hands on music. But I can't believe how many, I said in my talk, every day there's a new company doing something in the space of either make music from scratch, take something and morph it, some large percentage of music that you hear on platforms like Spotify, is generated to sound like something else, but it actually doesn't have any author, so there's no copyright that has to be paid. There are a lot of different reasons why many, many people are involved, and so I think it's huge. I've been in this field a while, and I haven't seen anything that's been as transformative as this, honestly. Good and bad, I think it's a really important time to get in there and make some good positive models, I think.
Yeah, that's very exciting. And Andy, kind of to comment on this, but also to go into like another topic that's a little bit related. I feel like in computer science, or many of the colleagues think of, this new generative AI tools to make computing very accessible. I mean, even when you, for example, write code, I mean, do you even need to write a lot of code nowadays to build sophisticated apps, for example? And so how do we think about this being as a tool in our domains? Is it actually a tool? Is it, or does it completely replace humans, say like financial advisors? And how do you think about sort of human involvement going forward?
Without a doubt, this is a sea change. If you look back at financial innovation, there's always been a very complicated and important dynamic between technology and financial innovation. If you ask Paul Volcker, the former Fed chair, what financial engineering has brought, he said that the only tool that he thinks has been really useful is the ATM. But that's actually quite a very important watershed moment, because the ATM basically gave all of us easy access to our money. And if you think about equivalent kind of innovations. Electronic trading is another example, being able to move your money at a click of a mouse. And I think that generative AI is at that order of magnitude, because what it allows is humans, any human, to interact with machines in a completely natural way. So we're not there yet with financial advice, but we're not far away. Robo-advisors is a term that popped up, you know, 5 or 10 years ago, and the initial robo-advisors were not particularly smart in terms of how they could manage your money. With generative AI, I believe that we're just, you know, 2 or 3 years away from really serious, useful financial advice for a very large segment of the population that can't afford it.
And do we see it as more like a tool, or is it a complete replacement? Like, for example, a tool meaning, you know, a person with a calculator or a person with a spreadsheet, now a person with an AI, like generative AI, or is it that it completely, do you think, in your domains replaces instead of humans?
I think that it may end up being a very powerful tool that is wielded by financial advisors that can now manage a much larger number of clients with a much smaller staff. And for maybe 70 or 80% of those clients, it can actually replace the financial advisor altogether. Doesn't mean that financial advice is going to be dispensed automatically for everybody, but what it means, like with the example that was given on looking at radiology images, you can basically do a lot more with fewer humans and have more accurate predictions when humans and AI are coupled together.
That's exciting. Any other thoughts on human involvement or creative process in general? Like,
I just quickly say about tools that this is probably true in a lot of domains, but in music, these models that are being developed are gigantic, and they're very complex, and they take, you know, a huge amount of time to train and a lot of machines, and so they may be pretty easy for the public to manipulate in different ways, but you talk about a black box without being able to get inside, and I think in a domain like music, where the most important thing is to personalize things and to be able to shape it so that, I mean, the only thing that matters in music is somebody communicating and sharing something with someone else. So I think we have to break open the black box so that it's not a very good tool right now because it's at too high a level. Yes. And I suspect that's probably true in a lot of other domains as well.
And maybe now connected to that, to move on, what do you think are some of the biggest challenges to really make this an important tool? Or if it were to replace humans, I'm not so sure. But what do you think are some of the remaining challenges? Marzia, for example, you talked about some of the things in your talk, but could you build on it a little bit?
I would say a big thing that we want to think about, I think, as a society, is how we want generative AI, or AI in general, whether it's discriminative or generative, right, no matter what the training objective is, how we want it to interact with people and how aware we want people to be about that interaction. Should we be required to disclose when generative AI helped draft your patient message communication? I mean, you're not required to right now, right? Should we be required to audit every generative model or discriminative model that does prediction in a healthcare setting to make sure that for you as a patient, it performs well? For the subgroup you belong to, it has, you know, reasonable results. We don't do that right now. And so I think we have to be very careful as technologists, as people who are so excited about this technology, right? Nobody on this stage dislikes AI. We're all on this train. But we're on this train on the research side in most cases, right? We're seeing this technology at its cutting, bleeding edge. We are not, in general, deploying it down to people who are in a rural setting, going into a primary care provider and maybe given incorrect or bad recommendations about whether they need a referral for a condition, because this model is not well calibrated on patients like you. And so I think those considerations are the things we need to think about. As technology takes over, as it works for most people, only the people who really need a human get a human, who's gonna have access to the humans?
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a good way to think about it. So we're almost out of time, so I'm gonna do something very round robin, very quick. You can have one sentence to explain how you think about it, but let's score it. So minus 10, would be that this is going to be so risky, so terrible for this domain that it's going to cause so much trouble. Plus 10 would be, oh my God, this is going to change everything. It's the best thing, best technology that I've ever got. And zero is kind of, people are going to forget about this in 2, 3, 5 years. So maybe let's start with, so let's start with Andrew from all the way there.
Yeah, okay, okay.
Where would you rate the impact of this technology from minus 10 to 10?
Minus 10 to 10.
I'm going to say minus 10 and 10.
Oh, wow.
I think we're going to...
25% probably.
We're going to see amazing things happen, both good and bad. And that and we will not make progress unless we see both things happen.
How about you, John?
Five.
Five. That's a good one. Todd?
This is like a prediction, or
it's like a prediction.
I think it's a struggle. I think we're at zero right now, and I think we have to get to like 7.5 for it to be really useful.
It's dropping as we. Marzi, how about yourself?
I think it's minus 10 and 10. I think there's a lot of analogies actually between our two domains.
Exactly.
Thank you so much, everybody. This is great.
Thank you.